So thanks for this early morning show up. We all know how Hyderabad is off late, okay? It is trying to beat Bangalore nowadays, right? So, and particularly this junction every day across, like, you'll see a lot of traffic. So what I'm going to speak today is AI in manufacturing intelligence. I just want to emphasize this manufacturing intelligence. And I want to say, what are the things we are going to explain? Sorry, you should bear with me. I have a very bad cold and cough. So, not a corona. Okay. So, the aim of this presentation is to show how ML and with AI used to make improvements in manufacturing. Okay. And then I have some specific cases which I have solved on my own where I'll be like to discuss with you. So, as we know, AI will perform manufacturing, quality control, shorten design time, reduce material waste, improve production reuse, perform predictive maintenance, and more. Okay? Just a cautious note, AI is now an augmentation to human work, and nothing can be substitute for human intelligence. Okay? I want to emphasize this. AI cannot be substitute for human intelligence and the ability to adapt to unexpected changes. Okay? So, people have a lot of perception. I can debate on it and we can talk about it later. Okay? So I would like to start with something like data science, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. People often get confused with these three words, and then like there are series of people talk about like what is data science, what is machine learning, what is artificial intelligence, like no, is there any linkage between that? Okay, and people use this word like data science versus machine learning. So some people say like, I know Python, I know machine learning, I'm a data scientist. Okay, this kind of a questions we often get. So economists like me want to emphasize this and make sure like what are these three disciplines. As I said, data science is a discipline where data is used and analyzed to test hypotheses, answer questions, and understand insights. Whereas machine learning is used when computational tools of statistical techniques are leveraged to give computers ability to learn from that and within the data. So as I said, machine learning is a computational tool, okay? And artificial intelligence is when computational tools start up possess cognitive abilities to help in decision-making process. So these three are interlinked, but the mother of everything is data sciences. So data sciences is a discipline, machine learning is a computational tool, and artificial intelligence is basically which uses computational tools to become a cognitive abilities to help in decision-making process. So all my presentation will be rounded around this. Okay? Now, we'll start with what and why manufacturing intelligence, right? So people have a lot of questions about what is manufacturing intelligence. So it's an engineer's job, what an economist like me doing there, right? So manufacturing intelligence should be an engineer's job. So what should we do there, like? So as I said, manufacturing intelligence in a modern enterprise works on a different branches. Like it works within corporate offices where the people like chief analytics officer, chief economic advisors will sit there, right? And then the utilities, energy data, right? Which is very important. And manufacturing, the production data is what is the key and one of the unused component in most of the data sciences. We'll see a lot of data scientists who are using social media analytics, who are using marketing analytics, who are using churn analytics, but production data where engineers used to use now has becoming a threat to improve a lot of things. And then we have a distribution and warehousing where logistics data. So manufacturing intelligence is a person who can utilize all these three data and present in a business data. So that's where the manufacturing intelligence will come. And it will help in identification of what is going to happen, and it will also help in defining the new processes. It will also help in delivering that seamlessly, and it will also help in architecturing the solutions and building the new models and new methods, and finally developing new products. Okay? So having said that, what is a manufacturing intelligence? Now, what is an importance of AI in manufacturing, right? It's a topic, if you go to Google and just put AI in manufacturing, you get so many things, right? But I just want to precisely say, it has so many impacts, but my focus is today is only on quality control, downtime of equipment, and predictive maintenance. Okay, these are the three killer things which is going to hamper manufacturing growth. And as I said, like today, how mature is the market? It's only 20%, right? That too, the top-notch companies are using it. Right? Now I'm going to talk about a concept, mathematics and statistics of Industry 4.0. What is Industry 4.0, right? So what is Industry 1, right? Industry 1 is nothing but like, no, the early stages of inventing a wheel and loom together will make some kind of an energy types. And Industry 2 is where with this mass production came into a picture, right? Industry 3 is where you talk about the automation, computers, and all other things. Now, Industry 4.0. So, are we ready for that? And how our labor forces are ready for that, right? This is very important thing, right? This is where a lot of research is going on. I'm not talking about technological research. I'm talking about research at an HR level, right? How our industrial forces are ready for adapting to Industry 4.0, the changes, okay? So Industry 4.0 is nothing but cyber physical devices connecting and giving a seamless data which gives 80% of junk and only 20% of the data. So like you talk about something like, you know, in alarm prediction algorithms, right? So where it gives 95% of false alarms and only 5% of true alarms. And then we need to improvise that, curbing that false alarms and working on the real alarms. So that's the concept of Industry 4.0. Now I'm going to talk about mathematics of Industry 4.0. Okay? So what is the mathematics? Right? We talk about automation, we talk about connections, we talk about cloud computing, we talk about Internet of Things, we talk about big data, we talk about integrated systems. So all together, if you put plus or multiplication, this is the mathematics of Industry 4.0, right? So how your production, how your all the things is going to impact it with this. Now I'm going to talk about statistics. What kind of statistics Industry 4.0 is collecting, right? It collects the statistics of root cause analysis. It collects an across the production tools in linked and fuel and engines, right? And then it also talks about like, you know, different factories, and it also helps in decision making. So having said that, it's always a business concept, mathematics and statistics together gives an live to all your data science elements. So I just want to share this. Now we will go and try to see how each and every component is going to create. Now, having said that, what is our topic we are talking about is manufacturing intelligence, right? So for doing manufacturing intelligence, what we require is the data, right? So how this data is getting collected, right? From the beginning, everyone has a data which you call it as like ERP data. Right? That's where most of the companies are running. And in my purview or in the research, ERP data is the tip of an iceberg. Right? It's not the full data. It has so much of data which comes with an MES systems in manufacturing. Right? MES is like gaining momentum. You don't even find a resource who can work on MES systems nowadays. Right? And then SCADA data, and then PLC, product life cycles, okay, and then sensors, and all these accelerators and everything. So all these data, whatever we are getting, is getting mounted, and then you can see, like, there are different levels. In level 0, 1, 2, it's only industrial automation, right? People talk about automation, digitization, okay? And 2 and 3, if it goes, manufacturing operations management. So you talk about inventory, you talk about product moving out, like, no, what is an lead time, lag time, everything. Then industry, the level 4 is basically the business operations and decision making. So all these 4 things, what I showed some time back, is interconnected here, right? These 4 levels where we require data. And then for getting these data sources, what we do here is, once you have a data sources, then we talk about the structures, like, you know, integrating platform of this data, right? So I'm talking about, and data integration becomes a big thing here, because if you don't integrate all these data together, you're not going to get the real depth of it. So that's where most of the people fail, right? So now you get a concepts like data lake, okay, which is a centralized data repository that allows you to store all your structured and unstructured data at scale, and you can store data as is without having any kind of manipulations or anything. So you can visualize, you can prepare dashboards, all these things are very evident. Like, and then you can see a lot of animated things which I'm trying to put, like, you know, how this connection happens between that, and then the technologies are there today to help, like, you know, Microsoft or a lot of other technologies, and cloud is being used everywhere. And then there is a still lot of these manufacturing companies don't go for cloud because of they have a fear of losing their R&D secrets and other things, right? So with this, data integration is done. Now, what is the big picture? Like, once you have data integration, okay, what is the process flow? So we all know, once the data is integrated, then the role of a data scientist will exist. So who uses a category of tools like R, Name, Gradle, Python, Hive. I can name so many tools, but I just use only this. That's why I kept this. And the data scientist, the first thing is, like, no, he will go with a visualization, then he do a data mining, then he build a predictive modeling, then he derive some data insights, then it goes to in a manufacturing sense, you should have a governance board, like, you know, what is happening at each and everything. And then it will also help in decision making, where you talk about ranking of suppliers to cost saving, and then help in an intelligent decision making. So this is a high level process flow of integrating data sciences with AI. Now we'll come to the cases. Like, so what are the different cases we are talking about? Today is, like, so I have worked on these 4 cases in my career, right? So the first one is raw material destructions, right? I'll talk about it. And then the second case is warranty analytics, no fault found traceability. Then the third case is energy cost reduction, eliminating the test process in mechatronics, right? Mechanical and electronics together. Then spare parts demand forecasting, and M2M log analytics, estimating mean time between failures of confessing from logs. Then we have a preventive maintenance from, So we have preventive maintenance from oil and natural gas with an IoT sensor data. These are the 6 cases where I would like to discuss, like, offline or today. And then I'll try to give 1 or 2 cases, so that interest of time, like, no, how we approach this problem and everything. So let me start with raw material destruction in a pharma. Like, so this is I really liked when I came here, and then they said, like, today we are having this conference with a plastic free. Okay, I really liked it. The reason is, how many of you really care about environment, like Greta? Right? So talk about any pharmaceutical company, right? So it's really helping us. Without pharmaceuticals, like, no, we really don't get up and do a lot of things. Like, no, everyone has some kind of alignment where they need to depend upon medicines. But how it is going to impact our environment, as well as how it is going to impact our cost to the end company, okay? So if you talk about any kind of a batch manufacturing process, most of the pharmaceuticals follow this batch manufacturing process. They are trying to get into continuous manufacturing process, whatever it may be, but batch manufacturing is one thing. So what happens here is, like, there are so much of people disposal and improper disposals happening. Let me tell you, like, I don't want to name a client, but this was the biggest pharma producer who is into baby products, okay? They prepare baby creams and all. So they say, for preparing one unit of one particular chemical, okay, they used to pay around $100 for one unit. I don't want to get into the how much of units it is, but the same unit they have to dispose, they have to pay $1,100. Okay? So the one unit of what they procure, okay, when they want to dispose it, when they will dispose, when the production is done, the product is not used, then they need to dispose it. Right? And then, where they can dispose, in India it is very free, right? You can dispose like, no? Like this. You can dispose it in a very nice river. What you need to buy is a big pipe, okay, which collect all the draining data and then goes into that particular thing, right? But if you see what happens in US, the FDA is watching how you are cleaning your floor also, right? So this is where most of the Western countries has a pain on destruction quantity. So they, for that matter, if a small plant dies also, there will be big protest. But in India, even so many guys dies, I'm not talking about only India, any developing country for that matter, right? There is no protest. We don't care, right? In this context, I'm trying to sensitize you, like, how an AI can solve these problems, okay? So as I said, like, we are trying to use the data from the systems. Like, we get an ERP data, we get an MES data, we get an cost data, we get an destruction plant data, how much capacity and all. And you know, there are different processes of destruction. The places where the rivers are not connected, what they do is they do a landfilling, right? So they dig some 4,000 feet or something, and then fill that with this. Okay, this is what is happening, and which concerned every one of us, like, no, how much we are trying to do that. So can we solve this problem with some kind of AI ML is the question, right? So I said yes, but it's not like, no, with only a heart you can solve it, right? You also need to put your brain, right? You are sensitive towards it, and then emotions don't go and then create your analytics into that. You need to have an emotions with your brainy nature. So that's where what we thought is, and then the complexity of the problem is, so you talk about only one product, there are different batches this production is done, and few batches the destruction will be there, and few batches destruction won't be there. Okay? And when you are having a destruction, the magnitude of destruction quantities vary according to the batches also. So Don't you see this is a complex problem for a statistics guys? Right? This is a real complex problem for any statistician. Right? So people say like, okay, 1, 0, like Jinda Tilis mark we have, right? Logistic regression. Put it and then we build a model. Right? But is it going to solve the problem? You are just trying to differentiate between destruction batches and non-destruction batches. Yes, you should learn that. But how are you going to solve this? This is where the concept of the statistics, economics, and mathematics comes together. So what we have done is, so I just want to tell you like how the data looks like. So data is not coming from one system, guys. It comes from different systems. So we have integrate all the data and then try to create it into a spreadsheet and then try to understand that how much of data is making sense and how much of data is not going to make sense. Right? As I said, the real task of a data scientist or machine learning expert is trying to use the data, what's going to be useful, and try to crop the data, what is not going to be useful. Now, we started, like, no, I just want to put a, like, no, as Friday morning things, like, did you guys, anyone experience this kind of a problem in your real life scenarios? There are a lot of practitioners around here, right? Yeah. So, how you solved it? No, I'm not talking about data dictionary. I'm talking about the complexity of the problem. In a complexity of the problem, as I said, there are certain batches where you get destruction and certain batches you don't get destruction. The batches where you get destruction and the magnitude varies according to the different ways. Like it's a random. There is no a fixed quantity which you'll get disposed. It becomes very straight, right? If you could able to dispose only a fixed quantity, it becomes very surprised. So, I was actually trying to do this and then like, no, took back to my PhD days and then like one of my friends was trying to solve the problem of two-stage Heckman estimates, okay? Which is an econometric concept. We call this guy called Tobin, okay? He has come up with something called Tobit analysis. What Tobit analysis will do is, it will use two-stage algorithm. The first stage, it will differentiate between ones and zeros, and in the second stage, it will consider all the ones and try to apply your regression analysis and other things and try to give you the magnitude of destruction. Right? So now I'm trying to connect these dots to business. Right? How you are trying to connect the batches? And so we'll get like something like delay in received days, maximum batch size, where you procure, shelf life of a product, okay, and requisition quantity, received quantity, number of components you mix, and number of finished goods, and delayed in production process, and purchased order quantity. All these variables are there. Now, I'm talking about, like, I'm going to take back to you a few slides before, where I talked about human intelligence is very important. If you give this to a machine learning, what machine learning will do? It will pick up, okay? It will rank the variables and give an importance and then pick it up. Now, why human intelligence is very important here? Like, can we control something on shelf life of a product? Right? Shelf life is by birth, right? It has some kind of endowment skills. You can't control anything, right? Similarly, can we do number of components in a product? No, right? Like whatever the components has to get mixed, it has to be. Right? Then what are the variables we can impact upon? So that's where human intelligence becomes a very evident. Though you have to use a machine learning, but human intelligence also has to get added to that. So what happens in an going forward, you can put in rule saying like, only consider these variables, but not other variables, if you have to do this repeated task. That's where it will be helpful. But That is called automation. Right? So once we have done that, okay, the story has not stopped there. We first want to understand the description of why certain batches are getting destroyed versus why certain batches are not getting destroyed. So we started to do a discriminant analysis, right, to understand the variable importance, which are the variables which is going to help you. Then we started with an unsupervised clustering algorithm. Again, it's not your k-means or something, because most of your data are alphanumeric strings, right? Because you get a batch numbers, you get a batch quantity and everything. It has to get into a lot of other learnings. Then, after that learning, then we have done with a supervised learning. I call it a semi-supervised learning, where I have used a decision tree and random forest to differentiate between that. Then I identified the batches which are getting destroyed. Now, I want to come to a sensitivity analysis. If we change a parameter of one particular thing, for example, that's where we are trying to link to business, right? Now I'm talking about a business manager, right? How he will visualize this problem, right? He says procurement department owns the ordered quantity, batch size, and all these things. So what will happen if you enhance your, or if you increase your minimum batch size quantity and reduce your maximum batch size quantity, right? How can it will impact your destruction quantity? Similarly, what will happen if you have any kind of a production days loss, right? You get into a lot of production days loss. So what will happen if you are trying to put some kind of a production plan and use an agile process so that you eliminate all these things? So it's going to be a game changer. So all that scenarios is basically helping us in an AI platform, right? That's where the decisions are going to come. So that's how we solve this problem, and then we could able to save a lot of dollars for this company. Okay, now I'm coming to a second case, spare parts demand. Most of us know how a companies will plan a spare parts. Spare parts inventory management is the biggest thing, right? If you talk about an electronic industry, right? If something goes, if you go for any kind of a service, then they say no, you won't get a spare part, you need to dump this, right? Which is going to create a lot of e-wastage again. So how a spare part demand starts with, and how should we plan accordingly so that, I'm talking from a company perspective, HPs of the world, or Apples of the world, or even for that matter, Samsungs of the world, when they're coming with an electronic devices, they need to have a spare parts planning, right? How this spare parts planning has to be planned so that you can never lose any kind of a customer satisfaction, right? So, in a service management, okay, you get a lot of analytic support. You get an asset management, you get a CRM, you get a service contract, you get a field services, you get a workforce management, you get a technicians, you get a repair, return and warranties and service parts. And which is again a gray area. Most of us never ever ventured into this, into a job market or something. So this is where, again, a lot of potential. You know what happens? I just want to give a small thing on warranty. Every company, when they are coming up with a product, they will keep some accruals for warranty buffer. So if you produce a product which is so reliable and where you don't incur into any kind of a costing, then what will happen is that accruals, whatever you kept, can be used in your R&D. Right? The reliability concepts will become very evident there. That's where the economist role will come. The warranty economist will be coming there. So in order to reduce the warranty cost, how to plan your products? The first thing is engineering side of things. where you go with a warranty, where you reduce your failures, you reduce everything. For that, you require data, right? So how this data is coming, right? So now I'm talking about something like, okay, there are different metrics which you see in your day-to-day thing. Like, you know, if anyone is from manufacturing, these are the metrics where you try to see every day in your thing. Like, you know, our SAP product or like, you know, Oracle product gives us this. So you talk about something like ARR, okay, which is annual return rate or repair rate or, okay, and you talk about AFT, which is, okay, what is nothing but your failure times, right? And you talk about something like shipments, how many shipments you are doing, where you are trying to do, and the crux of the problem here is CSOs, customer service orders, right? How a customer service orders, how many customer service orders you are creating. Everyone is very good to plan in call center to understand MES, okay, MIS data, right? So that you can plan like, no, the call center, like how can, how many agents you need to keep, how many calls we are getting it. But you just tweak that data back, or it will help you in predicting your return rates, repair rates, and it will help you in lot of cost savings to the company. So again, as I said, like time series forecasting has become a kind of a tool, because nowadays any kind of an systems is going to help in AutoML or some of these things. They will give, and Facebook has come up with something like Prophet, where you will get in forecasting. But again, so I'm trying to caution again and again, that's where you need to use human intelligence, right? So what happens, you do all these things and then give to a business, right? The engineering folks don't understand anything. They need an explanation. You say like, hey, I have used, I'm just trying to get, like, no, you have different methods, right? Hey, I have used a sophisticated method called ANN, and then it solved my problem with a high precision rate, and like, no, which I have a good accuracy, and all, okay. Still good, but tell me, where should I improve, right? It's not like a machine learning expert has to show his expertise on, like, no, putting a lot of mathematics and statistics to it and making it a complex. You can do a simple problem, right? But it has to get explained to the guys who will understand that and try to tell you, like, no, okay, this is where I need to improve. So that's where, again, like, no, you have so many methods and methodologies, and I always prefer to use many methods. Like, no, it's a univariate or multivariate. You have so much of methods where you can improvise and then again work on your accuracies. So again, I want to say, in time series, most of these guys, what I'm trying to see is, they use the same machine learning, like, no, what you call it as train and test data, okay? But I know most of you guys are following it, but I just want to tell, being a statistician, trained statistician, in time series, it's always in sample versus out sample forecasting, right? So you can, within that, your training and validation has to be, like, no, chronologically defined. Okay, that's the first thing you need to keep in your mind. If you don't keep that in your mind, what will happen is random picks, and then it will go. So you get a lot of packages which is going to help us in that fashion. So that's another problem which we solved, and then where we could able to save a lot of dollars to a company. Okay, now I'm talking about, like, I have 10 minutes, I'll just talk about 5 minutes, and then 5 minutes I'll open up for questions. Okay, so log data, okay, like, this is in very close to my heart, right? So what happens is, people are expert on what you call it as NLPs and all, right? But machines also speak, right? One machine will speak to other machine, right? So that machine will send sensors to other machine. So how this entire mechanism works, and what is that language? We call that language as M2M, machine-to-machine correspondence. And most of these machine-to-machine languages are given as in logs, log statement, right? So log analytics is something which is gaining importance, and it's a new form of a data where a lot of exploration has to happen, right? And people has a very fancy tools, like people use something like ELTK, or people use something like Logstash, or there are so many other tools which you can just put it and then try to get. It only gives us a good visualization dashboard. Okay? But the predictability, what is important? I'm just trying to narrate a case here. Let's say like ATM, right? ATM machines. So in an ATM machine, when the people are trying to use it, overuse it, you get a lot of alarms, right? You keep getting a lot of alarms. I'm talking from an IT operations manager's perspective. In that alarms, so what he will do is, it's a more reactive. When the failure comes, then they say, okay, we are just trying to address this issue, then it will come. So what will happen is, you need to have a predictive power to explain when this failure is going to happen, right? So from logs, you can actually say you are getting some signals, right? Those signals, and you get some metrics. If you correlate these signals with that matrix, so you can actually estimate the type of failure. Like what happens, you get an error message. So what happens is you just grab it and try to find error. So that errors will continuously come. You put it in a time series format again, timestamp analysis. So it is going to be there for 5 minutes, then it will auto-correct. But the real things will come after 20 minutes, 15 minutes. So if you can predict these scenarios, then that scenarios you are going to use it for future to predict it. You can solve a lot of preventive maintenance cases. So I'm trying to just take you through like how the log data sample looks like, and then like how log analysis made within AI, okay? So you can always use all your statistical techniques to do that, but you need to follow like events, log files, equipments, and notifications. Okay, and you need to link each and everything, then you are going to solve the problem. Okay, so model building, again, training, testing, you have to do, like praise and do things and get into that. So I could able to complete only 3 cases, but I'm here, like, you can reach out to me for any other cases which helped you or which ignited you to understand. Okay, I'm just trying to put my cases again on the board. Okay, these are the cases. So now you have 6 minutes time.